Hi Shraddha, welcome to Cinema Express. It's an
Thank
absolute
you.
pleasure to have you here.
How sweet. Thank you so much.
Let me begin with Mara first. The Mara has been called as an adaptation of Charlie, right? And I remember when Nerkonda Parvai happened, that you had mentioned that you didn't watch Pink because you didn't want Tapsi's performance to influence yours. So how did you prepare for Mara, and considering this is an adaptation, how different was it in terms of, you know, preparation and acting?
Nerkonda Parvai was more or less a shot-to-shot remake of the original, except there were some changes made, right? There was a fight sequence added and some just small changes, some cosmetic changes that were made to it. Mara, on the other hand, is an adaptation, meaning to say that there's just like a thread of thought which is inspired from Charlie, but there is so much more added that when you see the final product, you're questioning, is it, there's so much difference there. Is it really the same thing? And it's not. So I correct everyone who calls it a remake. It's not, it's an adaptation. Maddie and I were discussing the other day, the beginning of this film is different. The middle of it is different and the ending is different. So what is the similarity? So yeah, that's how it is.
Okay.
You also asked how I prepared, because I did not watch Nerkonda Parvai. How did I deal with this? In this case, I had watched Charlie. Right. And then again, when I was told about Paru and what she does and, you know, what the whole film is about, I said, I have nothing to worry about, because again, these are two very individual women, two very different women. And probably the only thing in common is that they're dreamers. They love to dream and they want to be free. Right. They're like birds. But apart from that, there's so many differences. So yes.
The director Dilip had mentioned that both you and Madhavan shares, you know, some of the characteristics with the characters you play. So can you tell about your part? Like, what do you have in common with the character you play?
What do I have in common? I also, like Paru, I'm also fascinated by old structures a lot. Sometimes, I mean, as a child and for the longest time, I've always wished, I said, I wish I had a time machine to just go back into time. You know, like whenever you go to a fort, let's say, and you see all these empty structures, you wonder how it was when it was bustling with activity and people were doing their thing. There was people walking around, soldiers, traders, kings, queens. And you really wonder what was happening there, right? And like I said, for the longest time, just wanted to go get into a time machine and step back into time, go back into time. So even Paru is like that. She's very fascinated by old structures. Why was it built? And she thinks that every brick has a story to tell. And that's why she's into conservation of old monuments. That's her kind of specialty as an architect. Yeah. So she wants to protect every old monument, because someday if they're gone, like, no, there will be no trace of them left, and our future generations will never know that this was built by this one and these were the stories attached to it. So I think this is one very huge similarity between the two of us. I'm talking as if Paru is a real person, but she is in my head, in our heads.
Definitely, definitely. I consider characters that way. So absolutely,
right?
Get you there.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, the timing is very interesting for Mara, because at least, let's talk about the spirit of Charlie, right? I mean, the spirit of Charlie is, you know, a lot of freedom. Both of the characters had so much freedom and they traveled so much. There was a lot of wanderlust happening. And from the rushes of whatever we've seen from Mara, that spirit is still there, right? And right now we're in a lockdown, we're in the middle of pandemic, where, all of this is into a huge question. And I believe the timing is extremely interesting. Have you thought about that?
Not until perhaps you mentioned it, but you're right. I mean, this movie... I mean, Mara and Paru are not just travelers. They're not backpacking around. But for them, traveling is also like a search. A search for something that they're probably, something is missing in their own lives. And sometimes, like, the lockdown for us too, interestingly, even though we were stuck at home, a lot of us delved into ourselves, searching for what is sort of like, you know, resting at the very, very bottom layers of our heart to learn a little bit more about us. At least I did. A lot of us did a lot of soul searching, sitting on our bed, inside yeah. our in our rooms. Mara is like Mara is just like that. Yes, of course the travel part has been retained, but for both Mara and Paru, the end goal of the travel is the search and to find something, whether within themselves or whether outside. So that way, yeah, metaphorically, yeah.
Okay, and this film also sees you get back with the Madhavan, with the pairing was craze when Vikram Veda happened. How do you think the equation has changed? Has the equation changed in first place?
Yes, from my side, it has. In the sense okay. that I was a bumbling little starry-eyed actress back then who was like, oh my God, Maddie. But now I've obviously grown up a little bit more. So I'm not like that anymore. But the equation has only gotten better. The chemistry that Maddie and I share in Mara is wholly different from Vikram Veda, but it's so beautiful and so profound. The kind of romance that you will see in this film, it's actually the romance that our generation needs. We are that, you know, like swipe right generation, social media generation. But this film is also a lot about love that, I mean, transcends all of this. The more physical aspects, the more, you know, the shallower aspects. So, yeah.
Okay. And talking about social media, I'm a huge fan of your social media presence. I think you're one of the few celebrities who's absolutely real, and it's so refreshing to watch. It's more like seeing a friend's profile than, you know, a celebrity or an actress. So, is this your way of staying grounded, real? Because I mean, a lot of actors do say that after they reach the stardom, you know, there's a mm-hmm. bit of disconnect with, you know, what's actually happening on ground. So have you ever faced that? Is this your way of tackling with it?
Yeah, for sure. This is my way of staying grounded, staying real. I want people to know that actors and actresses are after all human beings. I want to normalize being normal. I mean, I have been to like, there have been few rare instances, but like when I went out and like I could hear, like I heard one sneaky person say, oh my God, I can't believe she's a heroine. Like, you know what I mean? So I want people to know that this is how I am. Like there is no makeup on my face. And this is how I am. I'm very comfortable with being myself. When I am on screen, I'm an actress, but in real life, I'm just somebody's daughter, somebody's friend. And I do all the stupid things that you do, Asha. I'm just like you. I'm just like anyone else. And I want people to think that actresses and actors are normal people too. And I want more celebrities to be real. I mean, of course, it's their choice and there's nothing wrong with, I mean, just be yourself. That's all I'm saying. This is my small endeavor, sort of, yeah.
I remember in the starting days that, this was from one of the interviews, earlier interviews, that you'd come in with a very idealistic approach, but then you realized that you have to be street smart. And, but you also mentioned that you will never let go of what the art truly meant to you. So, would you, looking back, you know, it's like 4 or 5 years since you've really hit it big in the industry. Looking back, what would you say is your biggest lesson so far?
Again, I feel that I was not big on PR, or I was not big on like going and socializing and striking like parts, and you know what I mean? Without having done any of that, I feel like I've done a fair bit for myself. And I mean, a lot of people said, you know, you need to be attending more parties. You need to be like showing yourself more, like being more in the media in this light, that light. And I'm just too lazy. And I said, okay, maybe you mean well, but I'm not going to do it anyway because it's just too much for me. And I did not. And I still did okay. So my lesson, and I think what I would tell other people is that your work will speak volumes for yourself. So you don't have to do something you're not comfortable doing. Like something, if that's not you, you don't have to do it. So yeah.
And speaking about work, you're working in 5 languages. So I think that says more than anything else. And so I don't think there's a strategy here, but what goes behind when you pick, you know, scripts like across languages?
Ideally, I would like to equally sort of like sort of have my work equally spread across all languages. But then there are times that, you know, there's just like a very dry spell in one language and you're not getting anything, which is fine too. And that does not compel me to sign any film just for the sake of it, just because I have to like do one attendance, like present. So yeah, I mean, it has worked out perfectly so far. It looks quite perfect, but it has just happened on its own. It's just been like, yeah, whatever piques my curiosity, whatever I think I see myself doing, whatever I feel like my audience, my fans would like to see me doing, I go with that. I the worst, like, I feel like you can trash me as an actor, but when a fan says, you know, like, we thought she was like we thought she's capable of much more, or we're like she can do much better than this in terms of picking films, or we expected better of you, that just hurts. So yeah, I try to just keep it interesting.
Okay, and
Yeah.
this is your second digital film, if I'm right, after Krishna and His Leela. And the pandemic has actually, even though OTT was always there even before, the pandemic has sort of pushed it to a different level. And now that everyone's much more comfortable with digital and much more comfortable with doing OTT scripts, so as an actor, how do you see that sphere changing? I mean, I'm sure the theaters and the OTT platforms will coexist, but how do you see work transforming for you? Do you see more interesting scripts happening, you know, transformation in that sense?
I do. For me as an actor, it only gets better because your first day, first show dynamics are thrown out of the window to some extent. So I mean, yeah, it gets a lot better for someone like me who's not like a mainstream, like for the masses kind of actress. But yeah, I mean, I'm sure it'll coexist. I'm absolutely in love with this platform and the convenience, just the accessibility and all of that. But as an actor, like you said, I feel like it will get very interesting from now on, work-wise. Just the kind of things we can explore. Yeah.
Okay, and also you mentioned this one of your interviews that you were a bit scared to go back on sets after the pandemic, and what you would
Yeah.
actually told was it is very tough for an actor to keep honing your craft, you know, like a singer could
Yeah.
sing, practice, but it's tough for an
Yeah.
actor. So can you tell us about the first day on set and how did you get through that, you know, entire debacle?
Oh my God. Yeah, I was truly nervous. I thought that, you know, like I thought that I'd forgotten how to like act in front of the camera. It's such a silly thought, you might think, but I really did. I felt like I'm gonna make some like huge mistakes today. And I did. I felt rusty on my very first day after 9 months of not being in front of the camera. I definitely felt very rusty. I thought that I felt stiff, and you hate it because you want every day of work to be your best, but then I realized that, you know, I'm only human. I patted myself on the back. I said, "It's okay, you did the best you could." And then I eased into it, and it was fine. So probably the first day did. I'm not ashamed to say this, but it felt a bit like I probably was not the best that I have been. Yeah, you ease into it, and then you realize the camera is your friend, so you have nothing to worry about. So yeah.
Okay. What would you say a person can expect out of Mara when they watch it?
They can expect, I mean, they will end up feeling really happy. Just like a feel good film. You know, we abuse this whole feel good term so much, but I mean, something that makes you feel happy. You might just turn off your TV and randomly hum a song from Mara because that song stayed in your mind. Or you might think of a moment that you thought was so special. And there are so many special moments in the film. Like just the we have a huge cast and everyone is like excellent. So just like a good, positive, happy film about love. Who doesn't love to, like, I feel like we don't make enough love stories nowadays. Everything's so dark and morbid
Absolutely.
and like, yeah, you're killing people or like someone, this and that is happening, but there's not so much love really that's being shown. So yeah, it's gonna be a lot of like good positive thoughts, good vibes only.
thank you so much for the time, and absolutely looking forward to Mara and your performance.
Thank you so much. It was so lovely talking to you.